Welcome to our launch of Star Trek Picard, the tale of the Enterprise captain who was last seen defeating his own clone. So, you know, there's really nowhere to go but up from there. The episode begins with the Enterprise D while the song Blue Sky's playing, no doubt a reference to when Data sang that in Nemesis not long before his death. But right now, he's sitting with Picard playing poker, so I guess he must be feeling better. Right after Data wins the final hand with five queens of hearts, which I can't help but think makes him a dirty cheater, we see outside the window is Mars, and its surface explodes. Turns out, this was all just a dream.
Oh, number one.
Things have been so difficult since Q turned you into a dog. Woof! Yes, I said I'd call, but so far every vet says that there's no cure for being neutered. While Picard looks over the old family vineyard, we cut away to two people that we don't know, in Boston, who are both very excited because she just got a job working as a scientist at the Daystrom Institute. So this calls for a celebration. That's really not my idea of a good party. They start questioning the girl, but when they put a bag over her head, she just goes full Matrix on them, you know, kicks and blows and then grabbing their guns and just generally being a badass. I have got to say, I had no idea that they had such a high criteria for their research scientists. Your nonlinear equations are good, but can they stand up to my tiger claw? After the titles, Picard is going about his business in the vineyard, important work, talking to his dog, talking to the help. Sounds like a busy day to me. What we quickly notice is something is up with the people helping him, though. They are either Romulans or very well-dressed goblins.
I am beginning to regret that I ever allowed myself to be talked into doing this.
That hat? Yeah, I know. Janeway's been giving you shit about that hat for years. With Kurtzman as one of the people running this show, the Kelvinverse is naturally being considered part of the canon. So Spock did indeed go into the past, and Romulus was destroyed. They did fix it so that it was the Romulan star that went Nova, so be thankful for small mercies. This is all relevant because Picard was central to the Federation side of the controversy occurring around the Romulan supernova. He even stood up before the Romulan Senate and gave a speech. It's good they don't show the speech, because the Picard speech is cheating. People tell me things I've criticized. Oh, but it is a good speech. No, it wasn't. It's just that a Knight of the Realm Shakespearean actor is capable of making anything sound good. It's not the speech that was good, it was that Patrick Stewart gave it that made it sound like it worked. I mean, the speech itself was terrible. Just give the man one of Archer's speeches. Once I went to Africa, and I saw a gazelle. You see what I mean? If you gave Picard the worst speech ever, it would still work. I can understand the skepticism of the esteemed member of the Romulan Senate. After all that has happened, all that has come between us, can we now, at this time, make a change for the better, knowing the growing pains along the way? I find great solace, though, in the words of one of Earth's poets. Beans, beans! The magical fruit. The more you eat them, the more you toot, but the more you toot, the better you feel. So I say to all of Romulus, let's eat beans with every meal. There's tension because Picard agreed to an interview to discuss his role during that tragedy. And despite assurances, the interview quickly turns ugly. The interviewer interrupts Picard with other interpretations of the crisis than his. His was that we put aside the past conflict and helped the Romulans evacuate their world. He gave up command of the Enterprise to take direct control over a fleet of 10,000 ferries that would do the evacuating. As in ships, not pixies. Though I can absolutely see Picard saying, engage, and a swarm of pixies just go flying off to make the Romulans float into the air and escape. Well, alas, things went wrong, as we find out with this bit of exposition.
A group of rogue synthetics dropped the planetary defense shields and hacked Mars's own defense net.
Yes.
Wiping out the rescue armada and completely destroying the Utopia Planitia shipyard. The explosions ignited the flammable vapors in the stratosphere. Mars remains on fire to this day. 92,143 lives were lost, which led to a ban on synthetics.
Does that include nylons? Because those can be helpful with chafing, I'm told. She uses that to push Picard's buttons on Data, until when she finally asks about the real reason for quitting, he gives her an earful. First about how much Starfleet sucks, then about how much she specifically sucks, and then storms off. That was a friendly interview. I'd hate to see an unfriendly one. No, I'm lying. I'd love to see an unfriendly one, but then I'm a terrible human being like everyone else. Well, Picard's meltdown was witnessed by Professor Guncotta, and she had seen a vision of his face earlier, so she goes to see him in case he might have some answers.
What do you want here?
I saw your interview. Do you know me?
What?
Do you know me?
No.
Look at me.
Oh, shit. Ryza, wasn't it? That bitch told me she was on the pill. Look, I haven't got any money. I'm a poor, poor man, you see. Just me and my 120 acres and my 16-bedroom chateau, so just go away. She explains about the attack and her inexplicable ability to transform into Deadpool, and she's hoping Picard might be able to help because of the vision. Picard gradually starts to think that it might be true and lets her stay here that night. And she's not the only visitor. When Picard looks out, he sees Data painting under a tree in his vineyard. And he invites Picard to finish the painting, but I don't see how. There's no numbers on there anywhere. Picard wakes up only to discover that the girl left during the night for some inexplicable reason. But he's already got an errand to run at Starfleet Command. We get a great view of the Golden Gate Bridge and see it is now covered with angled solar panels, to which I can only say, riding that thing on a dirt bike would be amazing. But Picard is here for the archive, his own personal one that cannot be accessed by anyone else. And the giant Captain Picard Day banner, that's probably a good reason why he insists on that. He pulls out one item, and unsealing it reveals the painting that Data had been painting in his dream. It's almost identical to one Picard has in his home, except the face is visible. And it's that girl's face. In a painting titled Daughter. So, there's only one possible explanation for this. She's a time traveler. We pick up with her after the break, on the run in Paris, and talking to her mom on the hologram phone, explaining that she left so that she wouldn't put anyone else in danger. Her mom keeps pushing to go back to Picard, even though our heroine never mentioned his name. But still, repeating it seems to force the girl to finally comply, and she quickly figures out where he is and heads to San Francisco to try to get help.
So I did some research. I may have schizophrenia. Or maybe I had head trauma. The auditory hallucinations.
No, you don't have schizophrenia.
Then I'm a freak.
No, you're not.
She's high maintenance, isn't she? So he explains about his dead robot friend who painted her picture 30 years ago. Yeah, this is turning into dueling banjos of crazy. But amidst Picard's ramblings, he brings up one point that says that he might be onto something. The fact that tracking a former Starfleet admiral requires a security clearance that she cannot possibly have. So she must have some serious hacking skills. Even Starfleet wouldn't be so bad that every rando on the street could get their hands on the files. She insists that she can't be an android, though, because she has memories of growing up in Seattle. And the thought of being a murder machine, which androids are now considered to be, is just horrifying. So it takes a while for Picard to convince her that she's part of the legacy of a great man, even if he did cheat at poker. The discussion is interrupted when the mysterious bad guys locate her, so she, her name is Dodge, which might be advisable right now. Dodge and Picard are in trouble. If only we could get to Starfleet so they could help. Picard would actually like to get somebody, or just stop so he can frickin' breathe. It's not like he's been running marathons lately. But Dodge is insistent that they have to keep moving. The problem, though, is that running is not a long-term strategy when you deal with people who can teleport. So she stashes Picard behind a bench, then runs down to take out the attackers. You know, it's not many shows that set the tone of the first episode by hiding their wheezing title character so someone else can take out three armed assassins using nothing but martial arts. She takes down the first wave, appearing a la video game rules, but then there's the second wave, so she has to do a super leap up to give them more of the droid foo. During the fight, one of the helmets falls off the bad guy, revealing that he's a Romulan. But one of the fallen uses his last breath to spit some kind of acid that overloads the rifle and possibly her artificial body. It's kind of hard to tell the way it's shot, but either way, she's quickly engulfed in a fireball and there's just nothing left of her.
I will never leave you.
Why did you really quit, Starfleet?
This painting is called Daughter.
No, not in the face. They say that as far as the security feed was concerned, Picard was alone the whole time, which means that she must have had some kind of weird personal cloaking device, since obviously there is no way that Picard did all of that. Well, not unless he was to have some kind of incredible mental powers or something. That's pretty far-fetched. Picard is upset, more than just about the unfairness of her death, but with self-realization. As he puts it, sitting here all these years, nursing my offended dignity. Picard's heart was broken to see his Federation fail to live up to its ideals, but he realizes now that, rather than spending this time trying to do something constructive, he squandered that time, preferring to sit around fuming about being in the right rather than trying to restore its lost honor. Picard heads to the Daystrom Institute to talk to Agnes here.
How can I help you?
You can tell me if it is possible to make a sentient android out of flesh and blood.
Sure, you want fries with that? She says it's 1,000 years away, even if they were permitted to research it, which they can't.
Welcome to what's left of the Federation's Division of Advanced Synthetic Research.
Oh, I see, they're all invisible. She explains that any research they do here is purely theoretical. Actually, building a synthetic life form is outlawed.
But isn't it possible to create a synthetic that looks fully human?
The short answer is no.
Well, give me the long answer.
The long answer is fuck no. She shows Picard the dismantled remains of B4. As I recall, and forgive me if I'm wrong, it's been a while, but I seem to remember that in the comic prequel to Star Trek 11, we saw that B4 was now the reincarnation of Data, and still serving in Starfleet. But in this series, that didn't happen. Data's neuronet download wasn't able to work fully with B4, and so the android was just stored here. Agnes brings up Bruce Maddox from way back in The Measure of a Man, who still kept in touch with Data, as we heard throughout TNG. You know, despite what happens, his Data was incapable of animosity. They were getting close to making their own android when the ban happened. But they could have done it if they had Data's neuronet, which they don't have, but then Picard surprises her by showing the necklace that Dodge had been wearing, which has the symbol on it for fractal neuronic cloning. But I don't have to tell you the obvious. Maddox theorized that one positronic neuron was all it took to reconstruct the entire neural net, which means that if Dodge is what they think she is, then she has a part of Data inside her, or had, rather. Picard's theory is that Maddox made her and based the appearance on the painting that Data had made that had been named Daughter, feeling it was apt. Maddox was incredibly sentimental, which was obvious the way he wanted to pull Data apart to see how he worked. Agnes explains that their technique involves making androids in pairs, so there's a second one of her out there somewhere, and sure enough we find her working with the Romulans, with the name of Soji. And she is a friendly introduction to a Romulan named Narek. But what's the real story is the gradual pullback to reveal where they are. The Romulan Reclamation Zone, it's a deactivated Borg cube. How does that play into things? Next month we find out with Episode 2 of Star Trek Picard.
Thank you. All hail your